PHP has been something that I started with. It's a romance that I had with PHP because it's one of the first languages which has every security issue that you could really think of. I've been pen testing for around close to 12 years now, and am I audible the last two? I can't shout more. I probably need a mic.
There's a mic. There's an anthill somewhere.
Michael.
Where's the mic?
I need a mic.
You also have to compete with it.
Hello. It's better now. Okay. So I've done my introduction. I'm not going to repeat it again. Generally, a quick idea is that I've been pen testing, and I've been doing pen testing is basically break security applications. Our job comes in, we're trying to redefine ourselves in the agile world these days, but predominantly it has been applications get built. I come inside, find faults, and the developers go fix them, and I basically recheck. That's how my job has been. But that's been changing a lot within the agile. We are trying to doing a few things differently these days, but that's for another talk for a later date. My slide share, my PowerPoint is not. One of the things I did yesterday night was upgrade my Mac. Bad idea. A lot of things are not working on my Mac right now, which also includes PowerPoint. My databases are screwed, but as it's a workshop, so it becomes easier for me because you're going to do the job and I just have to walk around. Some things that are important from a pen tester. Why does a developer need to understand security? One, for the matter that you try and sometimes security issues can be very costly. Sometimes it needs the fact that you might have to redesign your whole applications a certain way. And that could be a very costly episode. And one of the reasons why you should be doing it is understand what we are really looking at. And security guys are also someone who understands code and who breaks according to the code is. So it is something that you could do ahead of time. That's what it is. Basically, that's why we do these sessions. The most important, content that I'll be sharing can be dangerous. Please don't hack applications across in the real world. If you do, you're responsible for it, not me. So the way I've done it, I've learned it is, I have given you a set of applications that are publicly available, like some things like Multiday, DBWA. These are available, so these are there for you to play around. There are multiple such things. I'll try and share as much as possible with you. But also is, we write our own applications. If you've pulled in some my code, there are some specific ones which are a little advanced, not necessarily that are there in DBWA, or some things where I find is a little wanting. We write our own, or we ask the developer to write it a certain way, and then we break into it and see what it happens. So I've given you both of it. So one thing that as a security we write is I sometimes write and my colleague breaks, my colleague writes, I break. That's how we work around it. So I've given you both the content around it. Please work with these instead of exploiting something on the world. It's too dangerous. I'll try as much less theory as possible, but quick hands, how many of you know what security is, have some brush around it? How?
People out.
That's not actually the case. That's what people think it is. You know, I'm a normal guy. We don't keep people out. Okay, I've had a few show of hands, but let me. So, for want, I'll try and cover a little bit towards basics and a little towards advanced, so that we get a little bit of mix. You know, we do everything around. Some of the things that I picked up today, so PHP, I have a 2-hour slot. Generally, if you go through the slides, it's a huge set. We do it over a period of 2 days. I was told I have 2 hours of time, so I tried bringing out some of the most unique things to PHP. What are the unique security issues that are there for PHP, and I'm trying to bring them out here. There are others, so it should be a constant quest. I'm sure, yes. Bigger. Better?
Bigger.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I'm not able to make it a slideshow. The PowerPoint is crashing, so we'll have to do with this. How many of you heard SQL injection? The whole class. Someone wants to explain? I'll make it a little easier. Let's say there is an application. Pretty much you've seen something like this, right? A username, password, and do you think this can be SQL injected? Like how? If you drew a drop table, sure. Is it really going to be useful to you? And what are the repercussions of doing a drop table? You don't want your administrator knowing that the site is down. Sure, it can be done. But is that what you would do?
Dumping.
Sure. What if it's more easier? What's the first thing that you would want to do?
Own the machine.
First step is to bypass the login itself, which is possible, you know. I learned, for me, generally it starts with SQL injection because that's the first hack I ever did. There was a site called Sunsilk Gang of Girls. It was an Indian-based site. And pretty young, not married before, wanted to know what women think. And that was the site we hacked. And thankfully, the site is no more. I think it's not working. I'll try without... if I'm not audible, just shout out and I'll try and come a little ahead and talk. So the thrill of going into a website with you don't have any authentication itself is truly amazing. Okay, so let's try this. If this is in place, I'm sure most of you understand SQL here, right? Most of you are developers. Let's say this is the query that is there. How would you bypass this? Sorry? How would you insert into this? This is a select statement. Let's say we want to just bypass a login. What would you really do? Huh? Yes. Yes. So the thing that is, you do something like this. How many of you have heard about this? This is very common. If you read anything about SQL injection, everyone talks about this. Let's take a minute to understand this, because hacking is also about understanding what the systems are underlying doing. It's actually a very simple thing. There's a typo there. If you notice, in the user I have entered single quote, in the explanation I have entered double quote. Factually it's wrong, but you should match the exact ones. So let's say I assume that there is a double quote there. So the first double quote that the user enters, so we are assuming here that the user is entering it in the username. So the first double quote closes the double quote that the application has put, or condition 1 is equal to 1. And you basically put a hyphen to basically comment out the rest of the query itself. Question to people is, how many, let's say this login table, or in this case, the users table has 100 records. How many records will come back as a response of this?
100.
Why?
Wow,
yes. Huh? Yes, because the 1 is 1 equal to 1 is true for all the records. And it's an OR condition here, so it's basically going to check at every record and it will be true for all the records, and that's why you will get all the 100 records back. But technically, you cannot log in with all the 100 records. How does the system work? It's a record set. They would probably have said that, give me a record set of 1. And you take the first record. And that is why technically you become an administrator. Because when someone writes an application, they generally enter the administrator record first. So there is no real guarantee that you become an administrator, but works. But if you read through the documentation, it doesn't generally come out so well on that. Okay, so first steps is, if you've gone through my setup.txt, I would want you to test this out. I want you to bypass a login and check. If you go to my link and go to setup.txt, so something, there is a website. It's run by a company called Acunetics. Find this website and bypass a login. Everyone has been able to install XAMPP and all the other files that have been given. Just keep doing that as we talk, because we might need all of them. Do we need to keep moving this all the time? Do we need to keep moving this all the time? Any luck? Someone's done already? Imagine this is your real application. You get paid to do this. Anyone done already? Yes. So you don't have any credentials at the moment. You got to log in. Go on. Tough thing here is to walk around, see what's happening. It's done. So you're on this website, right? Now you don't have credentials. I want you to log into this application. As simple as that. So you'll have to find out where is the login page first and then try logging into the application. Sorry?
Has already given a...
Try. So that's a good one. There is a test user there. Please don't use it. We have to learn SQL injection, so try doing it with SQL injection.
So it's not a trick question.
Huh?
It's not a trick question.
So it's not.
No, nothing.
Don't use test. So the test is basically there is another school of thought that it is a brute forcible user ID there. It's a different kind of an attack. So this application has multiple such security issues within this itself. So there are lots of issues. You know, this is not the only security issue that is there in this application. It has lots of security. One of them being the guessable username password also. Did you log in?
No.
Why?
I just tried. Sorry, I just tried like
No. You're complicating it way too much.
That's weird. Well, you can
or ID equal to 1.
Your spaces are wrong. Did you finish?
I couldn't see the it's small.
It's in the setup.txt. Open setup.txt and you should be able to see it. Be done?
What database is this?
I'm not going to tell you that.
So we're going to try MI, LS, or Oracle.
Could be anything. But you could generally take guesses.
Yeah.
If it's a PHP-based application, people generally use MySQL. That's actually a good question. That brings out a very good point that she brought out was, what first things that you think of a SQL injection is, you have to understand what is the background database that could be. Sometimes we will not know the answer directly, so you have to take assumed guesses. And a general idea of fact is, if it's an MS SQL or an ASP based application, MS SQL server. If it's a MySQL, mostly it's a PHP based application. It's generally the idea that is. The reason for that is, there are subtleties in how SQL works. So you need to follow the right SQL syntax for the database. I've been noticing that a few people are doing mistakes with spacing. You'll have to be careful about how you put spaces. And how many of you knew what I was doing when I put those hyphens? What does that mean? Correct. But with, so let me give you a clue here. This is a MySQL database. The MySQL database, the comment is hyphen hyphen space. It has to have a space after the comma. If you don't, MySQL will not work. Yes. So the way I work with it is, I always put hyphen, hyphen, space, hyphen, so that I visually know that there is a space in there. With that, is anybody able to finish it? You're done? Awesome. How about you?
No idea.
Let's go. Let's see. Go on. Let's try. Let's see what happens.
Well, I'm gonna test and
test. No, we're not doing that.
Alright, what do you want to do?
So this is going to be, so first things you have to assume is, a username is going to be a string.
Yeah.
Right? So we don't know the user.
Admin.
No, let's not do that. So let's say a single quote.
Okay.
Then we say, because so this single quote will close the quote that the user has opened there.
Okay.
You say or space, 1 equal to 1 hyphen hyphen space hyphen.
Close it.
We've already closed it. See this? We've already closed it. So we don't want to close it because we don't bother about what is there behind.
Oh, I see. So this part username is closing the actual.
Yes. Okay. And there's one trailing. So we.
I got it.
So we remove this. Your administrator.
I just queried like that just now. Yeah, and then I got in. Is this considered part getting or no?
I don't know. Stick to the login, but were you able to do the login?
Oh, as in going into the.
Yes.
Oh, okay. No.
So you've not logged in yet.
Sorry?
So type it out. Let's see what you're typing.
Sorry.
See, first things first, there has to be a space.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, so single quote. So what you have to understand what the single quote is doing. So the
it's like commenting out the other side.
The first, so when they're writing the query, the user, they would have started with a single quote, right? So you need to quote out that query, you need to close. It has to make valid SQL statements. So you take the first one and you close it with the second one. So you basically, this single quote will close the single quote. Okay. Then space or, so you, no. So you just do single quote, mm-hmm.
space,
or.
Or.
What is that? Or 1 is equal to 1. What is this in between? That's wrong. Go here. Uh-huh. Out.
Then you close the
quote. So, at sorry. So, remove that space. Put hyphen, hyphen.
Hyphen.
Space, hyphen. Login.
Without a password.
Your administrator. Okay. For people who have not done it, let me show it to you. So, think of it like this. So, are you able to see my screen? So, you start with a single quote. The reason being is you want to comment out the entry that the user has put. Then you put or 1 equal to 1 hyphen hyphen space hyphen and you log in. That's it. Now I'll throw a challenge to you people. Okay? The challenge is, you know that there is a user called test, right? Use the test, but don't use the password test. Log in as user test.
Sorry?
There is a user test within the application. So if you look at this, where is logout? Okay. Now, so you have test, right? But you don't know, let's say we assume we don't know the password of test. But you have to log in as test. How would you do it? It's all SQL. Think about it. It's in the same lines of what we spoke about. You have to log in as test user now. And I'd like to see your query string, what you will enter. No, don't use the same. There is a different one that you can do. Yeah, okay, then show me.
Okay, the one that I do is this one.
It's the same type. It's just that you don't know. See, in this case, what it is basically saying is, I don't know what username you have. You match all conditions and it's giving you back this.
Oh, no, I mean, if I username pass.
And I want in this a test itself. Like what? Sorry?
See? I'm copy-pasting.
Sure, because the SQL injection exists in the password also. I want it in the test. So,
you want it in the test.
In the username, you only should have test.
But without password.
Let's say you don't know the password. Yes, that's a good one. Just to clarify how I want it is, you know that only your username is injectable. The word test should appear on the username. Does it make sense? It's actually more simpler than what we did. Think about it. What did we do? Just to get your quick attention, what did we do? When we do this, what are we really doing? Let's go back to the presentation. What are we really doing here? See, if you notice, what we are really doing here is, this is what the developer has written, right? User input will come inside between these brackets and this between these brackets, correct? We put a single quote and we closed this one. And we did this whole thing. So what it effectively did is, all the records comes, the first record is picked up and then given to you. Now we know that there is a user test. Imagine in a real world scenario, there could be an administrator and the username could have a SQL injection in it. How will you log in as admin? It's actually more simpler than what we did. You've been able to do it? Correct. I liked what it, that's the exact right way I think it is, but it could be done more elegantly.
Okay.
Let me just show you. Let's log this out and.
Sorry.
No, I'm saying it's perfect. Actually liked what you did. It's just not logging out. So the whole idea is you're logging in as test user only. You don't have to bother about the rest. You just have to comment off everything. As simple as that.
Yes.
So. That's enough.
Yes.
That's it.
Oh, this, no need of close the single quote.
Why? You've already closed it here, right?
All right. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, you don't need to close it. Yeah. And if it's commented out, everything behind this, don't care.
Yeah, okay.
So you don't have to bother about it, right?
Okay.
That should do the job. That's the more elegant way of doing it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hello, guys. You've been able to do it?
No.
Sure. Did you do the first one? Did it work for you? Did the second one work for you? Perfect.
For the second one, how to
have? Think through it. See, now there is a user called test in the database. And we know it is guaranteed that test exists.
Yes.
So basically think from this query. What does it really say? Select star. See, think it.
Select.
So.
Okay.
When you're programming something, right? You're going to say, if a record set object is coming back with some response, it is a valid user. If that is the case, how do you go about doing it? So all you have to do is select star from only test and rest all, I don't care. That's your answer. Did you do it?
How did
just
you
the
do
test?
It?
No.
Just the test?
Yes, you just have to log in as test, but you don't know the password. No, you cannot enter it there. There's nothing to be entered in the password, but you have to log in as test.
So, you just log in as test?
Yes.
So, test username, and then you're going to have
to
have
password.
Correct.
Do I put a colon here?
Yes, you have to, right?
Yeah, right. So just had a...
Did you give a space here?
Yeah.
Yes, now do it. That's it. But did you understand why it's happening?
Yeah, you stop it, then you comment it out.
Yes. So you put it after test because there is a single quote there, and after that your test should close the username. And rest of it is gone. Try it on. I'll show it if a few minutes. Did it work? I think you should have done it, right?
Oh, overriding the password.
Sorry?
Which exercise is it?
So I want you to log in as test.
I logged in as test.
Not using any or is equal to 1 is equal to 1 or anything like that. So basically saying that you have to log in as test.
Yes, I did log in as test.
Can I see your...
I used the same approach again.
No, that's not the right approach.
You want another approach?
Yes.
Which is using what?
Think. Think using what query... So let's say you have a user test in there.
Ah, okay la. Then I can just do this lah.
Oops. I'm sorry, my internet went away.
You can log into the Wi-Fi.
I don't know. My laptop doesn't allow me. Michael already did. Okay, can you help me?
IDA@labs. Did you log in?
Yeah.
As test?
Yeah, switch it around.
What do you mean by that? Can I see?
Oh, wait. So, sign up. So here, I just type test.
Okay.
Okay. And then I just hit the...
No, you're not putting anything in password.
Oh, cannot.
Cannot.
Oh, okay.
I'll come in a second. Yes. No, you cannot enter anything in the password.
You don't want me to enter in the password. No. Just blank password.
Just blank password.
Okay.
Just to remove a few confusions, it is a blank password. You cannot enter any password.
I didn't. I just put in 1 equals 1.
No, you cannot. Why do you have to?
But I did.
It doesn't have to be. There are other ways to... See, it's all about learning how SQL works.
But it showed me love anyway.
In this application, it will.
Yeah.
In a real world, it won't.
Okay.
That's why.
All right. You're trying to bring us along.
So the username can only be test.
Yes.
And passwords cannot.
It has to be blank. And then you still have to become a test.
Okay. All right. Well,
it's all SQL. It's all how you play around with SQL. Can I? Perfect. I see a few people who have already completed it. Can we give a minute, or should I show you how to do this?
I did it. I just didn't do what I wanted.
You just didn't do what I wanted. See, the reason being I wanted to do this is to understand how it... See, every document that you read always talks about only R is equal to 1 is equal to 1. A developer could write a regular expression on his backend and say, remove R is equal to 1. If I see anything on that, I will not let you log in. That's how blacklists work, right? So that does not mean SQL injection is not there. So you need to know different ways of doing things. One of the ways I wanted you to challenge was to log in as test without putting anything in the password. But be log in. I think a few people did. Do you want to show them how to do it?
Yeah.
Go ahead. You can come to my machine and do it. You got it?
You curse it. And then this
won't work.
Comment.
Because you didn't give a space.
Oh yeah.
That darn space again.
And space. Yeah.
That's it. Did it make sense to you why it happened? The f- the single quote after the test closes the username, and then we put a comment entry to close off the whole query after that. So we don't care about the password condition at all. As simple as that. So you're starting to understand how it really works behind the wheel when you write database queries.
Yeah, the main thing is if you know the syntax of whatever database it is that you're talking to, you've got a fairly good chance of getting in there.
Yes. So in real world today, it becomes more a little more difficult. Nobody writes direct SQL anymore. We use ORMs. How ORMs work is they internally use the SQL, but they use parameterized queries. How many of you heard what is a parameterized query? One, two, three. Okay, let's continue with the presentation. I wanted to show you a few more things. Let's come back to this a little bit later. So, what do you understand? So, from what we did, what were some of the main things you thought was the problem of SQL injection?
String concatenation.
Sure, that was one way. What it really means is you can dynamically modify the query itself.
Yeah.
That's the problem. Parameterized query takes that away. It does not allow you to modify the query. And that's the secret of a parameterized query. Every application logic today supports parameterized queries. You should be looking, if you have to write, so though we use a lot of, the reason why we need to know this is, I work for an organization where we use a lot of ORM. But there are scenarios where we have to write dynamic queries. There are scenarios where we have to do multiple joins across so many things that ORMs cannot handle it. And we have to write a query at that point of time. We take extreme care whether we are creating a SQL injection kind of an environment. How do we check all those things? We check what user input is going into the query itself. Will it be able to manipulate it? Only if we are very sure about it, we let it pass into those queries. Though the number of such queries are very, very less, most of the time ORM should be able to satisfy the job that we really want. But there are scenarios where, if you look at it, ORM itself has some functionality where you can allow generic SQL. If that is the case, you have to be extremely careful. And it helps to understand these things. Now, let me talk a little bit about MySQL specific thing. How many of you knew within MySQL there was something called magic quotes? Okay, what is magic quotes? I can't really hear you. It adds slashes. So when we put that single quote right, it prepends it with a slash and it basically breaks the query. This is a security feature. The older versions of MySQL used to include by default. But this was discontinued. MySQL decided to pull it out of this because of a problem that people started doing. People started believing that because magic quotes exist, we can write bad queries. We can do anything and it will never break. Security is never driven that way. The problem that people started was they were like, oh, it's comfortable, it'll just take care of it, we don't have to bother about it. The result of that was the magic quotes could be bypassed. If you could send your payloads in hex, it would bypass it. The magic quotes would not be able to detect it. And that's the reason why they said, okay, you should, as a developers, you should be writing good code. Don't depend on the frameworks. And ORMs or no ORMs, I think it's something that you have to continuously keep looking whether we are writing good code there. So this was some of the basic SQL injections. Now, I was actually going to be talking a little bit about something like this. Are we doing good on time? Okay, I will just give you a quick brush through and move to the other ones because I still want to cover up some sets around things. Sometimes you may not get errors. Here we were getting one quick thing is someone can actually try, say, put a single quote and just press enter and see how the system responds. Within your application here, just put a single quote and put press enter. See what does the system do. Ah, unfortunately it's not. But generally applications give out an error. When you put a single quote and you don't terminate, MySQL creates an error saying that null terminated string. So basically saying there is one extra single quote. I have two, but it's become three now, and it's not closed. So it basically says a null terminated string is there, or some kind of an error is there, which basically says you control the MySQL environment. This is called an error-based SQL injection. Sometimes errors will not come back. There will not be something that will tell you that there is a database in the background. How do you deal with that then?
Keep at it.
Sorry?
Keep at it.
Sure, that's the way it is. But there's a concept called the blind SQL injection. What it means is you manipulate your queries in such a way that you will be able to understand that you can control this query. Let me actually show you a demo. Instead of you doing this, let me show you a demo. Are you able to see the URL here? This is the URL that is there, okay? Now, let's say there is no error that is coming back and I have to do a blind SQL injection. Something that I will be doing is, and see, it's the same values, right? But I'll just copy this. Now, the next one that I entered was this. Do you see a difference? Yes. Correct, but how is this helpful in this context? I'm sure everyone knows it's a 1 and a 2. Huh? It's actually very simple. So think of the behavior changes that happened. You saw a behavior change, right?
Yeah.
The first one, it showed some data. The second one, there was no data. That itself should tell you something. That means I can control the query. And also please notice, art is equal to 1 is the default one. That is what the developer had thought. But we are now adding content into it. What did we add? Percentile 20, which basically means space.
Yeah.
And we've put an and condition there. And said and 1 is equal to 1, which basically means art is equal to 1, and 1 is equal to 1. Is 1 is equal to 1? Yes. When you put an and condition, both have to be true. Correct? That's how logic is, right? It's an and operator, so it effectively means both have to be true. In the second one, 1 is equal to 2 is not true, so it becomes false. True and false is always false.
So you break it.
That's the behavior that we are really looking at. That makes sense to you? So sometimes even if you don't have errors, we can use things like this.
That's telling you that it's SQL.
Injectable.
Injectable.
Now, you can continue to work on this because we'll have to save some time, do the others also. We will cut this out. One thing I'll tell you is there is a tool called SQL Map. How many of you have heard of this? It's a Swiss knife for SQL injections. You may just want to download this. In this specific URL, all you have to do is, SQL Map is a Python-based application. So it's sqlmap.py hyphen u and give the URL. It will do the attacking for you. Don't have to bother. But learn the fundamentals. It's very useful to learn the fundamentals before you start using the tools.
That helps.
Yep. Largely. See, because there will be scenarios where the tools will not be able to find out problems. We've not covered things like second order SQL injections. Those are not something that SQL Map really works well. But it's a little advanced for the specific session we are. Maybe once you build up a little bit context, we can come back and do those things. Just to add a little bit, and 1 is equal to 1 and 2 is not necessarily the only way. Sometimes you can ask the database to sleep for a few minutes. So let's say you take a request and the request takes 20 microseconds and you sleep for 100 microseconds. Your total response time becomes 120 seconds. You know you control that environment. You can totally take over the database. Okay? All of you have installed the XAMPP? Show of hands if everyone has installed XAMPP. You're done or you... XAMPP. Okay, so let me quickly show you. Once you install XAMPP, I have a Mac. Windows users, I don't know how... shouldn't be much different. I'll come and see yours if it's coming to it. Won't work. Maybe you'll have to pair with someone. We're now going to use a tool called DVWA. We're now going to look at one of the very famous PHP attacks called file inclusions. How many have heard what is a file inclusion attack? Okay. I keep getting one hand up.
Somebody else is shy.
See, one of the most, if you typically looked at a PHP-based application, and if it was at least 10 years or old, you can be guaranteed that there is a file inclusion attack. Because that was the norm, that was the design pattern they used. So you would definitely see it. But what it effectively means is, when a script loads a file could be from a local machine itself, and it is using that to display some content. And if you can control that file or what it is going to load, you have a file inclusion attack. To do this, you need to install DVWA. The way you do it is very simple. Once you installed XAMPP, if you have downloaded the DVWA, it is like a zip file. Unzip that file and place it into your htdocs folder. If we do this for today, that should be enough because that should creates a hacking platform for you to play around. A DVW has multiple security issues. I'm just looking at one of it today. Because we'll keep moving one after the other.
Safe to download it?
Very good question. Now, if you download this, please assume that if you put it on your machine, remove it before you even do any browsing or any of those things. Because these are vulnerable applications. And if you run a database with as a root, you're on the internet, someone can use this to hack you. These are purpose-built vulnerable applications. Please do take care of them. It's not just exploitation. These are exploitable. That's a good question. So please do care. Use them, but So the way I work is I always know that I will shut down my servers. I know my servers are there, I will shut it down. Period. And use your firewalls basically and use it with care. Are you doing it or you don't want to do it? Sure, go ahead.
Because I am SSH key and hosting.
Maybe put a VM and use a VM to do it.
Well, the Mac has it's all the hasty docs already, right? So I can actually put it there.
Yeah, but you can create a VM, install the exam inside the VM, right?
Oh.
It's a separate environment. My content is all separated on a virtual box, so you can do it something like use your Docker or use your VM to do the job. Or pair with someone.
I just watched.
Problem is, I may not be able to show some of it because my database is not working. So you'll have to pair up with someone who's doing it.
Is it possible that this kind of app is actually stealing your SSH key?
No, it's not.
No, it's not.
See, your app per se is not hacking you. The app is not hacking you. But let's say someone knows your URL. Like my web servers have been tuned to that it will work only on 127. Nobody from outside can access those pages. So if you do all those things, yes. But the app per se is not going to hack your machine. You got the point? But if you have these apps and you're on live, someone else can hack using these apps on your machine. That's what it is. If your SSH keys are there, it doesn't make a difference. Your app is not going to hack them. Excuse me. Did it answer your question? So you can actually create a VM, install it on a VM, destroy the VM as you go. Stuff like that. How will you learn otherwise? See, you have to be paranoid. But does not mean you don't do it. Security is about being paranoid about what you do. But you have to do the things. So the way you do it is you create VMs, keep seclusions, and you still learn what you have to learn. Have you been able to set it up? DVWA running? How long do I have it till?
Another hour?
Okay. Maybe an hour and 15 minutes I'll use up. Yeah, I have enough. Because this should need some... Huh? It's already 3, right?
Yeah.
So 4, I should try and see. Because the other person will need some time at least, right?
Yeah. You think you can stop by 3:30 to 45 minutes or so.
Okay, now we got a rush.
No code is DVWA, right?
Huh? The folder is DVWA.
Yeah.
So slash DVWA. Local host,
yeah.
You put it in.
Yeah, DVWA.
DVWA.
Okay.
No, there's no I.
Okay.
Alright.
What?
Okay.
Oh, one.
Change the name to.
Yeah.
Quick question. Let's say you're browsing to a web application. How will you know that the web server is a Linux-based web server or a Windows-based web server? Sorry? Let's say all the headers are removed. Someone is cleaning it up very well. What could be some of the things that could be very subtle things which are very useful? I saw him, so I just got the thought in my mind. No. Do you know the behavior between cases between Windows and Linux? Uppercase, lowercase. A Windows will support both the cases. Linux will not support it. So you take a file and put it in all caps. If it works, and you try it in lowercase, if it doesn't work, it's a Linux machine. If it works for both scenarios, it's a Windows machine. The reason is why you did that is when I thought about it. So you'll have to set up the server. So, hey, why is it not able to connect? Okay, so what you need to do is, so can you just go to the DBW? Then, where's the dbconfig?
This one, config?
Yes, inside config.
Okay.
Open this. Is this the password? I think by default is empty like this.
Okay.
Check create reset. Is your database running?
Yeah, I saw it running just now.
It is running. You don't need this.
Okay.
So, do you know what password you set for this?
No.
I think it just download by default.
Yeah.
So, what is the default? Can you just Google for find out of our, is this exam or mmap? This is exam, right?
Yeah.
So, just say exam, what is the default password?
Root.
Sorry?
Root.
What is the password?
I think the default is root. User's root and the default.
So then you need to put the password as root and then just check. Hold on.
No, this thing missing.
That's okay. That shouldn't be the problem. It's not connecting. So we need to.
Everyone else has the same issue.
Let me just check. Have you been able to set it up?
Which one?
The exam.
I have IIS. What do you want?
Oh God.
Sorry, I didn't.
Okay. Anyone else done this till now? Has anyone been able to set up DVWA?
Not able to.
You have a similar problem as me. So what it is telling you is, do you know what is the password for your MySQL environment? It's telling you that the password is wrong. Can you just Google and find out what is the default password and then... It's blank. Just put space.
Yeah, I'll try, but...
Doesn't connect?
But is the DB correct or not? The name, database name correct? Is this the database name?
No, the first one is the database it's going to create. That's okay.
Okay.
So that should not be the problem. It's not connecting to the database. That's where it is. It is Apache because AIS will not support PHP, right?
Okay, then I'll run it.
You can download exam for Windows.
It's alright, I have it.
Did it log in for you?
No.
What is the problem you're having?
No, I checked before. I checked the password called.
Password?
It's called.
Password?
Password.
Just type put password.
It's not the one for the at symbol.
Without the at symbol, yeah. Please work. Can you just give me this once?
Yeah.
Let's restart the... I'll just be back. Let's look around and come back once. Did it work for you now?
No, I think I will uninstall and go back to mem. Maybe it's like cheating my mem. Because my mem installation, I think maybe it's overwriting or something.
You said you have mem, right? You're not going to use exam, which is fine, which is not a problem.
I was thinking, like, just now you're saying, like, the servers get hacked and all my files are all, like, you know.
It's okay. Remove the pages as you've deleted.
Yeah.
are very careless.
You have to be careful, otherwise it's not going to work. So you're starting to look at SQL map. Oh, you got it.
It's running.
Yes.
I don't know what to do here.
Admin password. Just put admin password. How did you get it? What is the password, default password? Can I see your DB config? Yes. One login. So I can you just give me the files? Where did you install DBWA? Is this DBWA? Login to go inside it. There is a DB config, right? See if there is a DB config. There is a config folder, cd config. Cat config. Password is blank. No.
Oh no. This is for the MySQL. I changed it. I didn't use the XAMMP thing.
Ah.
I already had a Apache and a.
You had. Okay, so I can't use your logic. Okay, but you seem to get it. So let's wait for a few minutes so that I know if. Did it work for you?
So once you have that DBWA installed, and you log in as an admin.
Yes, you log in as admin password.
Okay.
By default, it's admin password.
Yeah, admin password.
You've logged in.
Yes, but what do you do afterwards?
I'll come to it. Okay. I'm hoping others also can do it.
Okay.
What's the problem? See, did you install XAMPP?
It's not XAMPP. Like I have already PHP MySQL separately installed and Nginx is there. So I just set up everything locally.
Then is this the password correct for the database?
No.
Go down.
Okay.
Setup, create reset database. Click that. Go down. Yes, it is done. Now we'll click login. Go down. See there. Okay. Login. Admin password.
Password.
I'm sure you can help the others here.
Yeah.
Have you been able to set it up?
Yes.
Admin password. Did it work for you guys? Put up the?
Sam, I don't know how to install. I'm a Windows person.
Sure, what do you need to install?
This, the XAMPP.
Okay, just leave this. You want to install the DMG, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just double click.
She tried, it didn't
work.
I'm not sure, maybe it's something stopping it?
Yeah, it's not working. So maybe re-download it. It's not properly.
Yeah, I re-downloaded.
This is just now, this is earlier.
Yeah. So.
Why is this not working? Can you get up? I'll take your machine. Did it work for you?
I really have to install last time.
Okay. That's okay. You can use any web server, any environment. Fine. Shouldn't be a problem. Which one?
Broke my instance. Better not.
It's just installing a database with files. You can clean it up after that. You can give my name. Shouldn't be. It's a known risk. I'll tell you what we're doing. So we're pushing a set of PHP files, and we're pushing a set of SQL files, and we're installing the SQL files. That's it. We're not doing anything more than that.
Okay.
So once you're done, just delete the DBWA folder from your... That's it.
But why are we running this?
Huh?
Why are we running this?
This is going to set up the database in the background.
For us to play around?
Yes.
I thought we were going to execute some penetration test.
We will do it after this.
Okay.
So,
oh, wait.
Oh, click that.
Which one?
Click that button.
Okay.
Go down. It's not connecting to your database. Why? Is there any controls that are placed on you to install anything? Can you install any other applications?
Yes.
Can you install all applications?
Yeah.
I'm saying, basically, you should be able to install any application. You're not able to.
Yeah, I mean, like, I was able to, in the morning, I was able to install, like, download some stuff.
Is utilities. I'm not able to figure out why it is. Did it work for you?
Just put in one.
Correct.
My memory.
Correct, correct.
Then how do I reach?
Just go to localhost DBWA.
DB.
The one that you posted right now there, right? Did you paste it as DB? Change your folder name so it's easy.
Oh, yeah, sorry, I have another topic.
Did it work for you?
Left with Kapsha.
Don't bother about it. Don't need to have it. Just setting the database. It's not connecting to your database. Check if your database is right. And then go to, see, once inside your DBWA folder, go inside like this. Go inside config. There's an include file there. Check if your password is correct. Change your password. And save the new password and just create it. Go down, you're done. Say login, admin password. Why is it not coming? Did you shut down your database? Sorry, you shut down your Apache server. And just refresh, it should work for you. Maybe you can just pair with her. If this is not working, you can just join with her. any of you all got it working?
What's the login?
Sorry?
What's the login?
Oh, what's the login?
Yeah.
Admin password. Did you be able to set up? Not yet? Maybe you should pair up with someone. Admin password. Okay, I think most of you have been able to get it. So let's continue. Did it work for you guys? Let me show you. It's easier that way. Did you be able to set it up? Why? Okay, we'll troubleshoot it. Give me a second. Maybe so that we just save time. Okay, once you log into your can I have your attention? So, I know some of you have been able to set it up. Use this, you have it with you, you can set up whenever you want it. But what I want to do is something called file inclusion. Okay? We come to this page, click this page, look at the URL. The URL is something like this. What does it tell you? That's the URL in the behind. I've just copy-pasted the URL so that you can easily see it. What is it telling you? People, you have done it, exploit it, show me what you can do with it. What do you guys think? Anyone?
Is it just rendering the PHP file?
Okay, go on. You have to attack this. So, how will you attack this? Think about it.
You can just change the file to or any PHP file.
Correct. Sure. It's actually correct. So what kind of a file would you then write? But let's say this is a local file inclusion. So there are five. She got a very good answer. She told me, I will not give you the answer yet because I want you to think through it. There are two kinds of inclusions. One is called a local file inclusion and one is called a remote file inclusion.
Can I put any PHP somewhere else?
And then what would you do it? Think about it. I'm not going to do remote because it will exploit my machine. But I'll show you something interesting. But you're thinking the right way. Did anyone of you get what can be done? If this is the kind of URL you see, how can you exploit this? Where can you upload a PHP file here? To anywhere? Yes. How will you attach the file here? You're going the right way, but where will you attach? Where will you attach the PHP file? Sorry? There's no form. All you have to do is that URL. All you have to do is that URL. Huh? No. All your exploitation can be done in that URL itself.
Link it to, file1.php and link it to some other file on a different server.
I didn't get you. Like what? What are you thinking?
Because file1 is now a file that's on the web server.
Correct.
So you're trying to point it to a different
Correct.
File somewhere
Correct.
Else.
Yes.
And get the server to run that.
Exactly. How will you do it? You exactly right.
Putting the URL into page equal. Putting the URL of a different file in the name of the file name.
All you have to do, it's perfectly correct. Instead of file1.php, give a URL path. And it'll exploit, it'll take a remote file, include it in itself, and hack the server. Did you guys get it? Okay, I'll give you an example. What I want to see, I am a Mac user, so I'm going to be from very Mac biased. I want to see your etc password. You know, Mac machines have /etc/password. So instead of using a file name, can you just say /etc/password? Will it then show the server's etc password, right? As simple as that. It's a remote, so it's basically, there are two, like I said, there are two kinds of inclusion attacks that are there. One is the local file inclusion, and one is called a remote file inclusion. Depending on whether you can read remote, if it's a remote, it's actually more dangerous. Can someone answer it, why it's dangerous? Sure, what kind of dangerous threats? What kind? If you really think about it, what would be the most dangerous file that... So, I don't know if people have got it. Let me show you this, how it'll work. Instead of this, put /etc/.
Oh,
Not going to leave that for long for you guys to see what all packages I have installed. Huh? Sure. But did you get it? Did you? If you do this, you should be able to see your password file. But in a Windows machine, for Windows users, you should be able to see your boot.ini. But this knowledge of mine is pretty old. I don't know where that boot.ini of a Windows machine is anymore. Or it can be technically any file on your file system. So you can actually say, I'm seeing most of you are Mac users, so except you. Did it work for you or not? Did it work for you? Did you be able to start it? Yes?
No.
Why? Did your database problem solve?
Oh, yeah, I created the database.
And did you log into the system?
I can't log in because the login page is not set up.
Why?
I'm not sure
why. Can I see?
About connection video section. I don't have the driver.
It's saying it's not able to connect to the database.
Can I replace it with a simple connection string, or it has to be this?
It has to be there, this one, because we don't want to modify their code. Sure. We it'll become difficult. Let's see. Sorry. Is it working for you?
I got to the page up.
Okay. Say click file inclusion. Okay, click this. Let's try. If it doesn't work, then I'll set it up for you. Change this. Mm-hmm. Just remove file1.php. /full. Remove the whole thing. /etc/password. Enter. File not found. Okay, we'll have to fix the php.ini for you. What it is doing is there is a control where it's not allowing you to read. I'll come to your machine and I'll fix it for you. Did it work for you? Why?
I scanned my existing website.
Okay, so you have not started it, you have not installed it, fine. Wait, I'll come. I can't hear you. What?
I don't use
teaching. So, probably what it is doing is the php.ini is not allowing you file includes.
Okay.
Did it show you an error on that page?
No, we enabled it already.
You already enabled it?
Yeah.
Sorry. Did it work for you?
There's a file for, but I tried, it can't load. But it can load other file, like file 3.
Yeah, it's able to read, right?
Yeah, but I tried to load file 4.
So it will be able to read. My expertise on Windows is a little low, but I'll fix that. Then we'll come here and I'll come. But you're able to read the files, right? But only within that root.
1, 2, 3.
Yes, 4, 1, 2. Yeah. Hey, why 1, 2, 3? You should be able to read in a Mac. You should be able to read a whole system.
So 1, 2, 3.
Correct.
But there is a 4 which I could not read.
Don't bother, you can actually read anything on the system. Remove that include.php.
File not found.
Ah, okay. One thing that you need to set is, maybe it's not set for you also. Can I just see your machine? Okay, where's your DVWA?
Reports.
Ah, correct. Hey, if you see on the left-hand side, there is something called a DVWA security. Set it to low.
Oh,
you cannot hack it with impossible. It is so basically this is also teaching you to protect. If it is an impossible, you can read the source code that it will never be able to hack. Set a low. Maybe that's the problem for you also. And that's why you were able to read only in the directory. First things is, open up your php.ini,
okay.
Search for this allow URL include,
okay.
And set it to on.
Okay, I'll do.
Huh?
Okay, I'll do.
then remove this. So technically, you should be... Hey, did it work?
Yes.
That was the problem?
Yeah.
So I can now // or go anywhere?
You can. /etc. /etcswd.
So it's infected.
It's not infected.
Yeah,
okay. Think about what kind of a thing that you will inject in such a way it's dangerous.
Is this supposed to be the...
Correct, but you need to set your this one to low.
I set it already.
Then why is it not working? And let's see your file inclusion. See, you have not turned on this one. Open your php.ai now and change this to on.
Hmm? The script that downloads a shell file.
What kind of yes?
A shell file, then it can RMRF everything.
Shit, don't think dangerous. So you shouldn't do RMRF. See, okay. Think of it like this. When you do an RMRF,
export the database out to somewhere else.
It's more simpler. Take a GET request, send it through exec. And you have a shell which you can exit any system commands into the system. As simple as that. Make sense? You never do an RMRF. When you're a hacker, you don't do it. The reason being is, if you delete it, the administrator will know. You don't want administrators to know. Huh? And now we are at this one. Okay. Admin password.
I was figuring that problem. I was like, I got a database.
Did you get it?
No.
Okay. Oh, I'm so sorry.
I think the function is not
here. Yes, turn on that function. And then see, look at... Okay, hold on. Let me... First things first, change your security level to low. Then go to your file inclusion. Change this. Let's see if it works. If it doesn't, then we'll go change it. Touch your password file. Yes. How many of you know how passwords are stored in Linux? Is it enough to just see the /etc password folder? Yes. Passwords are broken up into two files in Linux. One is the etc password and the shadow. I'm not going to show you my shadow. When you get the shadow, you're still not going to break it. You will get the hashes, which you can use John the Ripper to break. But to see a shadow file, you need to be root. One thing with hacking is, not necessarily that the web server... So what kind of a credential... So there was a very interesting thing that you said. Till now, we are doing this /etc password, right? What you could do is write something called a shell, a web shell, which you can download for matter if it's free, or you can get it. And instead of etc password, say /http://prasanna.com/shell.php. As simple as that. What would happen is, our program will now connect to prasanna.com, take the shell file and execute it locally. And what you have at that point of time is a capability to run commands on the server. Thing to notice, the server will if it is running with the lower privilege, you only get a lower privilege. So you might be able to read a password file, but you may not be able to read the shadow. Make sense? So that is where the next level is comes in, which is what we call the escalation of privileges, which is maybe something you can pick up later. Where, yes. Still not working? Maybe is that the php.ini file? And what did you change the security settings to low? And still not working? Then we need to see.
Search first.
Set it to low.
Correct. Go to file inclusion.
File inclusion. buttons.
Click, 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 click one of them. See on the tab, file 2.php.
Yeah.
Remove it and say slash etc slash password. Remove, remove.
Oh.
See, it is trying to read exist. That's also wrong. That's it. Because it is reading exact files. It's reading the file and showing you the output.
Okay.
For you, it may not be etc password. It should be a Windows file. Try reading your boot.ini. Don't ask me where it is stored though. Did you get any other files outside?
As in C drive one, yeah.
You can read C drive, right?
Yeah.
You're able to read all the files there. In your own machines, you can write web shells. Try executing it, but I leave it to your later date. Don't do it now. You can't download. There is no point of download here.
What's
the behavior? The behavior is you should be able to read files.
Yes, yes. So I added it into the parameter.
Correct.
Yeah.
Remove that and put whatever file you want to read from the file system.
I want to try this because it's in the same folder.
No, don't put the same folder. Read something which is outside the... So it can read even to the extent of C drive.
Okay.
It can read any file on your system now.
Let's see.
No, but you need to give a path.
Huh?
You'll have to give the full path. C
yes,
colon.
Yes. So it's D. It's just in D.
Okay, so give the whole.
See, it's D.
Okay, now.
Huh? It's secure?
No, it's not. Let's go. No, hold on. Did you set this one to low? Settings, DVWA settings to low.
Okay, maybe you help me. Where do I...
No, go back to your page.
Okay.
Go back to your web page.
Just remove this.
Huh? Yeah, remove this. Just load DVWA.
Mm-hmm.
Go to DVWA security.
Mm-hmm.
Go down. Ah, see, it's impossible. Set it to low.
Ah, okay.
Now try the same thing.
Okay.
I think Windows, I see, for Windows users, I think you cannot put a slash. I think you should put double slash.
Oh, okay.
I think something like that is there. For Windows does not accept one slash. You should put two slashes, all that kind of.
Forward, I think, because it's
Apache, right? So, but you got the attack, right? You understood what the problem is.
Yes, yes.
Hey, did it work for you? Anyone on this table? Okay. You have it running? You're still not able to connect to your database. This is a problem. Do you want to go pair with someone and then be able to do it? Or let me show this. Oh, you saw this, right? So maybe try resetting it at home and try figuring it out. Because the reason is I want to rush. I have 15 minutes to do the other stuff. Just moving along a little too fast. The next one, I don't want you to guys to do it. I'll show it. I'll explain what is the hack. Because we doing it, we are not going to... we don't have time for it now.
Yeah.
Sorry? Is it okay? The next one is an installation. I don't want them to spend too much. Let them do it at home. The other one that I wanted to talk about is a very interesting hack called XML entity injections. Have you heard about this attack?
Yeah.
I keep hearing the same people's names.
Yeah, sure. I heard about it.
Sorry?
I just heard about it.
Okay. So for this one, like you've installed DVWA, for the second one, you have to install another tool called the multi-day. Please do it at your home, do it in your separate environments, whichever you want to do. I'm just going to show it now so that we save time. I'll give you a little bit of fundamental behind this one first. Let's say there is an application which accepts XML. What kind of applications accept XML? developers. There was an older system of, if I give out the name, you will know.
XSLT.
One.
Hey, I got one.
SOAP. SOAP.
Oh, SOAP, yeah.
SOAP is an XML message, right?
Yeah.
So, the reason I ask you is to, for you to start thinking, where can you hack? When you're using an application like DBWA or any of these applications, the weaponizing of the attacks doesn't come very quickly because you think, hey, I'm just entering something and it, something is happening. You should start thinking in the real world how things will be. In real world, how do you get XML? For an XML entity injection to happen, the web server needs to consume an XML. That's the prerogative, start one. If that is the case, you have to start thinking, what all scenarios do we get XML? One of it is SOAP. And if you can create a malfight SOAP or something like that, you should be able to play around. So let me give you an example. There seems to be an example here. You copy this, you paste it here, say validate XML. What happens? Don't worry about XML. If you see this kind of a behavior, what is the first kind of hack that you will think of in your mind? You're able to inject an XML and you're seeing some output on the web page. What's the attack that you can really think of? Quickly, what can you think of? Huh? Sure, but why HTML alone? You can inject JavaScript also, right? Yeah, well, that's a good one. Actually, that's what I was looking for. The most obvious thing that you should be looking for is a cross-site scripting. Does that make sense? In this case, cross-site scripting will not work, or you should do a little bit more to make it work. Your default script alert script will not work here. Your homework is to figure out how to make it work. But now let's say we want to inject in such a way that I can control. We did a file inclusion, right? You could do a similar file inclusion kind of attacks using entity injections. Okay, let's do this now. I forgot where I put the exploit. Just give me a second, please. Where did I put my... Yes. What do you think is this? This is an XML. What would happen if this XML gets executed? This is all the basis to create an XML entity injection. Someone said they knew what is an XML entity injection. Can you explain this XML? Anyone? Okay, I'll explain. If the parser is vulnerable, what it will do is it, when it is going to build the output, it is going to do something called, it will take this entity directive that is here, execute it, and the output of that one is going to be put here. Do you see it here? The entity is called XSE and the address of the entity has been put here. Make sense? So whatever is being told to be done as an entity will be executed. The simple or the XML parser will execute the entity. The output of it will be made a part of the XML itself. If that is the logic, think what you can do. You can effectively do anything that you did as a remote file inclusion. Okay, so let's execute this. You see the output? You can create a shell. It doesn't have to be a remote file inclusion. You can do anything that we did in the previous using the same attack like this. You can Google and find out that there are multiple applications which are vulnerable to XML entity injections. It's not a theory, it's possible. Okay, now I have a challenge for you people. I have a, can I take some more time? I have a web page. So can I have your attention? So I have an application here called one.php, which takes a username and password. I was lazy enough to not write a form. This is a beautiful tool, which is called Hackbar, which allows me to write posts. Unfortunately, this will not become bigger. I'll show you what it is at least on a. Did XML entity injection, I rushed through it. Did you guys understand what it is? That is the URL and this is the post body. Oh shit. Okay. You have to hack this application to get the flag. A flag is something that we play in, so like developers write code to keep their knowledge stronger. Most of the hackers we work with something called capture the flag, which basically means that we have to hack the application, get the flag and prove that we've been able to hack the system. So there is a secret flag within this application. You have to find out what is the problem. To help you, what I'm going to do is show you the source code of this one. Okay? And let's see how much can you break this. How many of you are PHP developers here? Four. Oh, the rest. Okay, challenge for you too. Sorry? I'll forget it. Okay, a clue for you that the folder name is called array. It has been named array for a certain reason. Think, just a clue for you. The secret is in this file called foo.php, which I am not going to open. That's all it is. If you notice, include foo.php. So that means I have included that file inside this application. You have to, if you really see through this, you need to know username and the password. How will you break this application now? Your coffee was useful. If you guys want to see within your machines, if you have pulled the repo, which I have already given to you, you will have that file with you yourself. It's inside a folder called array. Within the security folder, there is a file. Please don't open the foo.php and tell me the answer, because I will want you to tell me how you exploited it then. But I want you to read the source code and tell me how to hack this. This is a weird behavior of PHP. Think, what is the system doing? You've downloaded the source code? You have, right? Okay, see this, but I've already shared the source code. You can download it. Go ahead. Good one. That's what you should be looking at. Think, what does each function do? How do you break? What is the, so just to think of it, what is the operation that is being done? How do you break that operation? Sure.
You just need to recreate secret within the two parameters of passwords.
Correct. So in real world scenario, if you knew the password, what would be the output of?
It would be flag.
The secret is to read what that function does. What's the output of that function? Then only, if you understand the function, is when you can get this. Sorry? Hey, this doesn't need SQL. This is not a SQL thing at all. This is a very PHP thing. Secret is not here, right? You don't. It is inside the foo.php. Yeah.
Look at it, it's only flag.
It doesn't. But you really don't need it. You can bypass it without it. Oh. Should we time box it? Has the next speaker come? Oh.
So we're taking a break.
Yeah, I think people definitely need it.
After your talk.
I had coffee, nobody had it. Anybody answers? You want to play around with it and see? I didn't get your question.
What kind of tool that you use?
Hackbar. It's a very useful tool. It's for Firefox. Allows me to do posts and stuff like that.
What's the challenge of this again? What's the challenge for this again?
Challenge? You're asking me what is the output?
I mean,
want to get the flag.
You want to get the flag.
Basically, he wants to get this between 5 to 6 to echo the flag.
Yes. How do you get it?
So obviously, we can put in admin as the username. So how's
yes.
The string case cam.
Exactly.
To, give us the password. That's the
okay. Should I give you the answer? Do you guys want to answer, or do you guys want to think for some more time? Huh? Sorry, something to do with? No, that's a different hack. Not on this. No. There are multiple such gotchas within PHP itself. Okay, see. The secret of having this one is the string case compare.
Yeah.
The output should be a 0. If the return type from this function is a 0, it is going to consider as it's acceptable. Now, if that has to happen, how do you do it? In a normal condition, you cannot pull it off. But if there is an array with any of the inputs that have been passed in, it automatically sends out an output which is 0. So if you put it as an array, how do you put it as an array? You go and say password and something like this. If you convert your body, hey, where's the one that we were working on? Okay, I'll open a new one. If you make your body something like this, you got it? You see the flag come out now? PK was here, show off. Let me just open the foo file. So you got the logic? It actually goes and executes what we wanted it to do.
Show the
trick is here. Which basically means you're sending in an array. When you send an array, the way PHP works, the exit out of it is a 0, which is what we wanted in the first place. Make sense? So the next one that I want to do is a very interesting hack. This is something that you could play around with. I have given you the files, so you can set it up and you can play it whenever you want. Unfortunately, my database is not working today. I did the same presentation at DevOps Days 2015. This, per se, the exploit that I'm going to show now, has no fix. This bug was found by a gentleman called Stefan Esser. I have a lot of respect for him. This specific exploit has no... the way it works between MySQL and PHP, there is no fix to this itself. So I'll show you a video now. Because I can't show you an exploit, I'm actually showing you the video. This is the same exploit that I had created some time back. You have the source codes with you, so you can create it yourself.
Are you able to see?
No.
It's a login. It takes a user ID and a password.
The target of this test is...
Sorry?
Let me tell you what is expected of you also.
Huh? That's as big as it gets. That's... Once I finish the video, I'll show you the source code. I'll run through the whole thing, explain why the problem is also.
Put that mic, the wireless mic by the
Yes, so that you get the sound, yes.
We try logging in with this, it says try harder. Some of us have done an OSCP would know what a try harder is.
So what you basically, it is similar to this one. You have to log in with a username password. Let me give you a premise before this. You again have to log in as a username. You don't know the username password and you have to log in again. Hello? This is not working.
It is a little bit. It needs to be turned up.
Hello?
Battery drive.
Bear with me a few more minutes so before we set this up. It cannot fix. You take the latest MySQL, latest PHP. If you write a code like this, it's vulnerable.
Depends on the code.
It depends on both. Yes, in a way, it depends on the code.
Yeah, because the other one wouldn't have an exploit if you didn't write it that way for the password.
Yes. So you have to choose how to write your passwords. Anyway. So the whole idea was, string comparisons can be dangerous. You need to be very careful about how you do your string comparisons. That was the previous one. But this one, I'll give you the name of this hack. This hack is called SQL truncation exploit. So does it make sense?
No.
Yes. So the logic of this exploit that I'm going to, the logic of this exploit that is there is, there is an administrator within the application. You also have to become the administrator. Only administrators are allowed to see some content. God, it just...
Hello? You just come here because of your positioning.
Hello?
You're behind the speaker, so it's okay, but we hear it.
Okay, I didn't know that.
We don't hear you.
Maybe I shouldn't touch it, something? Okay, I'll continue as loud as I can. So you have to become the administrator, okay? But there is already an administrator. And if you look at the source code, we are also checking the passwords. If the password is equal to the same password, so you cannot create another administrator per se. Okay, so once that is done, let's look through this. I'll stop at few places.
Now, it also has a whole functionality called register.
So wherein there is a register, where you can create users.
Option click and try this and try now.
So
in
particular, you can actually register
users here. Nice. Thank you so much.
No problem.
I'm so sorry for that. It happened in live, so you can imagine the...
It says, admin's already registered, you cannot register that admin. But if you have to become an administrator, how do you do this?
Admin is already registered.
Some of the known tools for SQL injection happens to be a tool called SQL Map. How many of you have heard of SQL Map? Okay, I see a few of you. It's a good tool, it's an amazing one of the best tools available today to break into a SQL injection or find out SQL injection based attacks. So the reason I kept it as a URL is it's very easy to run SQL Map with a URL. Just hyphen U and put the URL there.
So I'm running a SQL Map here just to prove that you cannot use any SQL injection tools. And so I told you, right, some of it cannot be detected with SQL Map. It's one of the good examples.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Someone told me font has to be made bigger.
So if you see here, Python-SQL Map, we're going to hit enter. It tries everything. It basically tells that the user parameter is not injectable. So if you run these tools, it would actually say, hey, looks like you're not injectable with a single injection. You are safe. The other tool that is generally advised is Zap2. It's an amazing tool. I'm personally a lot of believer of Zap is a great tool. You run it through this, It does not find any SQL injection. All it finds us is three issues. It says that X frame option, if someone would know what it is, stops an attack called clip jamming. And some of the stops and accesses. So it basically said that three parameter header-based systems are missing. That's it. It did not know anything about how I could become an admin or how I could do a SQL injection in this case. Now let me just go a little ahead and actually perform the attack. What I'm going to do is, if you look at the admin, I will do it. What I'm going to do is enter this as a username.
Please watch one, this.
2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8, 9, 10. X.
Please notice what I have done. I cannot create an admin, but what did I create as user? There is a register.php which can create users, right? I have created a user with admin, 10 spaces, followed by an X, and password whatever you want. Okay? Any questions till now? I could have just copy pasted.
Okay.
User registered.
Now, let me just say. So, if you notice, I have actually created a user, admin space, 10 spaces, put an X, and then I have put a password saying 12345. Effectively, it bypassed the system. The reason why this happened was,
I'll tell you the reason. It doesn't have to be the video. The reason it happened is truncation. The varchar, when the user was created, the table had 10 varchar. User, varchar, 10. What did I do? I said user, 10 spaces, and an X. Correct? So if it is varchar 10, or it's not technically 10, it's I think 15 or 20. So, or exact, you need to think on what is the exact number. What would happen is, at the way it behaves is, it will, so let's say if your file, in this case, user is user 4 plus 10, 14, plus 1, 15. So I sent 15 characters, right, totally. Let's say the varchar value is only 14. The way MySQL behaves is, it removes the last and stores what it can. So what it does, it store in this case, admin, 10 spaces. That's why it's called a truncation bug. It removed the X. And when you do a select statement and say, give me select star from users for admin, the way MySQL PHP works is, admin is equal to admin space. It does not bother.
It doesn't care.
So what it did, so if my login sequence is like, hey, give me for all users who are an admin and password equal to whatever it is there, it will come back as a record set. And generally the way we work is, if the number of records is more than one, you basically give a login through. You got the problem here? Any questions on this one? So this is where it's called a truncation attack. You have to figure out how much is the length of that database field. Put one extra more than that. You give it spaces and give the last one as something that you know we should get destroyed.
So you can just keep trying.
Yes.
You can just simply keep trying until you get to the truncation part, and then boom.
Exactly. I wrote the code, so I know it exactly. Otherwise, you have to try. There is no other way around this. Find out what is the amount of varchar space on that. Did it make sense? Did this attack? This is actually not solvable. If you write, so what do you think as a, you've been developers here. What is the fix for this problem? Sorry? Can't hear. Not really. There could be a much easier way of doing it. Huh? No. There's actually one SQL thing that is very useful. There's something in SQL which helps you do this.
Well, you could not write it immediately to the database. You could like you said, trim it in.
Yeah, but what if you just set an unique constraint? As simple as that. Ensure that you, whenever you pull out data, you have a unique constraint. That's it. This will never happen.
Unique
constraint.
Constraint.
So the way it, then it, when it, when you're setting it itself, it will say, hey, I have a value already which is admin.
Okay.
And it will not allow you to save the data inside. As simple as that. That solves the problem. Sorry? You had a question. I can't hear. I'll come. Sorry?
The developer and the database designer is two different persons.
Which is where the problem is.
Yeah.
You should think.
You're saying the easy way to solve this is there are null constraints?
Unique constraint.
Unique constraint.
Yes. You had a question.
So the string replace with space.
You will not remove it. See, the problem is not with the space at all. So the way it works is when you put admin 10 spaces and you put an X, and your total where care available is only 14. This is 15 characters, right? So it will drop the one character at the last, and it will store only 14. So when it, I'll show you the source code now. So what is actually technically happening? It is one user admin is already existing, but now the next record is admin 10 spaces. But when you're doing a select query, there is no difference between an admin and an admin space. That's why this log, you can basically break it. So when you say select star from login, where user equal to admin and password equal to whatever the user puts, both the records will come. Because the way PHP thinks, admin and admin space are the same things. Make sense? Let me just before we go, I'll show you the source code because it's fun to. So.
That's what it is, I think.
So the fun is in register.php. Is it enough? Yeah, are you able to see it clearly? Okay, so I'm taking a username password. First things I'm checking is if the user admin is existing or not. It clearly throws out the user saying if you try admin again, you cannot log in. Next, if the password is equal to something that the user has already entered, it does not. But let's say that's not a control. Look at what am I doing. MySQL, insert into user, user password. Okay, the way I created is the user field was varchar 14. So when I enter 15, it will only store 14. It will not store 15. Okay, it's as simple as this. But now let's say you open this and see how login works. User equal to, I have hard coded it to be supposed to be admin. Still, I'm able to log in as admin space, right? If you see the video, it said that welcome, you're an administrator. The reason being is like this. See, the output, how did I check? Once I get the output, if the record sets is more than zero, it will be more than zero because it will, for admin, it, and I have created admin space with the password 12345, it's a valid record. It will send back that record. And I have basically logged in there.
So even so this still exists?
Yes.
Even if you use it? You are using
ORI
system?
Any system. This is a the way PHP works. you'll have to work around this one. So think about putting a unique constraint around it. Or trim, all that is definitely a possibilities. How do you do it is totally up to you. You could read about this. This specific one is called a SQL truncation attack. I wanted to do something more, but we can keep it to a later date. Let's call it. It's already more than my time allowed. Thank you so much. If you have any questions, please do ask.